singers, especially mezzo sopranos and colored shorts, there's a full-on Yma Sumac cult. She's no longer seen as a freak. She's really seen as a very specialized talent.
Your name?
My name is Skip Heller. I was Yma Sumac's guitar player for the last two tours. And working for her was always disorganized. It was very... Her management didn't seem to know what they were doing, and the music director was just scared to death of her.
Who was the music director?
I will not say. I think he's still alive, and there are libel laws in this state. But hanging out with her was a joy because she told wonderful stories, and she was a great storyteller. The idea that her English was limited... No, it really wasn't. She would play that up a little bit, but she was really articulate and funny with fantastic comic timing. I really... nobody ever says, you know, people like Yma Sumac, because there were no other people like Yma Sumac.
Do you remember any story that she played? I mean, that she told you about it?
She told me that during the time they were making the Mambo album, Billy May would come to the house every week, and he and Vivanco would just get roaringly drunk. And she said the first time she ever saw Billy May sober was when she got to the studio and saw him conducting, because up to then he always had a drink in his hand. And apparently he was, like, there are stories about what a legendary drinker he was.
Oh, how funny.
But, and she told many stories about, like, knockdown, drag out public fights with Moises Vivanco after he got their secretary pregnant. Which is probably, she actually told that in the press, so I'm not telling a story out of class. And she would always, if you looked depressed, she would just look at you and go, "Viva Feliz!"
Oh, like, nice.
But she would yell it at you like it was marching orders. It was really... As I said, I never met anybody like that. I've only seen one person who can sing like that. And I just met her the other night, and that was Lena. And playing with her was... it was really... not just what a talent, but you really felt like she had an entire culture uploaded into her. It was just such a joy. So you will never hear anybody like that again for the first time. You will never meet anybody like that. And, you know, like, there, trust me, there was a lot of difficulty in working for her. And, you know, Damon referred to himself as her occasional dartboard, which is accurate. But the other thing is, like, she cared about people. So when she cared, she loved you. She would always look for an excuse to have her arms around you. And then when she was angry, it was a freaking death sentence.
That's nice. Did she say anything about Peru or anything about her roots?
She said it was, when she was growing up, it was so beautiful. And that, like, one of the things that she wanted to do with her singing was to capture the beauty of the wind and the birds, because that's when she was learning to sing the way she sings. That was Peru. That was where she grew up. And, you know, she wasn't listening to records. She was listening to her home. So when you hear her, you're hearing that's Peru. I'm getting choked up because we all think about our home a certain way. When I hear certain music from Philadelphia, I'm like, that's us, you know. But I never made it so pure as to this fella right here. Good to see you again. Yeah, I had to drive by and pick it up. But the purity of her expression about her home, because she did learn how to sing literally from the birds and wind, and those were the things she was imitating, which a lot of kids start out with that, but her gift is so enormous and so prodigious. So for her to be able to distill the Peru of her childhood in this port town, and, like, now, the port towns are not glamorous, but when she did it, it was just magic. And that's why we're still here celebrating her. I also, and I said this the other night, she would deny that she's 100 years old.
For sure.
I saw her passport when I traveled with her to Canada. It was my job, Dan.
That was something of the time.
Oh,
you know?
She was like, oh, I was so young when I did Voice of the Extabay. I was just a young girl. You were 30.
Is there any anecdote that you remember, especially from her? Something, I don't know, that made you laugh or made
I'll
you
tell
sad?
You, there's one experience I really love. She liked the food chain of Pollo Loco. And they would let her bring her little lap dog, Chilito. And Chilito was as much a part of the story as her voice in her later years. So we would go there, and we were talking about music, because I was just curious. Like, I was very curious, and I just said, like, you know, hey, how did you, how did you learn about the Latin rhythm? She's like, oh, well, you know, when we were playing in New York, I heard the Mambos, and I heard Machito, and I heard this one and that one. And she goes, you know, and they would sing, and she starts singing this percussion parts. And then I would sing it like the birds sang it, and all of a sudden she starts doing that. And everybody in Pollo Loco just turned around, like, I mean, I'm surprised they didn't stand up and applaud, because it was just so beautiful and everybody knew they were in the presence of something magnificent. And the dog just looked up at her like, yeah, Mom does that at home. So that's maybe my favorite memory of her, is her singing that impossible stuff, sitting down in El Pollo Loco. And here's another thing related to that. She never warmed up.
Oh, really?
She said, no, I save it for the stage. No warming up backstage, nothing. She would walk out, start with her lowest note, go to the highest note in the first song, and she really hit her marks, man. She was unbelievable.
Wow. And what a privilege. But you're very young. You know, you made it.
I was maybe 31. That was the other thing. Like, I was a lot better looking back then. So every time, like, I would go someplace with her, she would be on my arm.
That's so nice.
It was very sweet. As I said, her temper was legendary, and it was the stuff of legends. But when you saw her, when you saw the, what I would call, like, the range and depth of her talent, and the fact that when she came up, she was like, at first she was treated almost like a freak, you know, like a gimmick. And a lot of people I know work with her through the years all said the same thing. Like, at first they thought we were making fun of her. I never had that to deal with, because she saw that I knew her music very well. So she knew I took her seriously. But everybody I knew said, like, at first they thought we were making fun of her. Or she thought we were making fun of her. And then after she saw we loved her, then she was telling stories about flahoolery and this and that. So it's like a common theme is, I don't think she realized that we knew how brilliant she was.
Oh, really?
I think she felt like she had to prove it all the time. It's like, honey, we've heard the records. You're amazing. You know, and you're regal. You could run for queen, and we don't even have those in this country.
Wow. Yeah, she was really something that I don't think, as you said, because she just portrayed the wind, the birds, and that Mother Earth. It
yeah.
doesn't get old.
No.
It will last forever, because her singing is just, I think, universal and timeless.
And pure.
Totally pure.
There's like, nobody can tell you, you know what? You know how you could sell a lot of records? Do it this way. It's like, it's not that. She's that was a pure and artistic instinct, and the fact that she managed to invest that in so many different things for so many different years. And when you hear her sing, you know, Mambos, or when you hear her sing that wonderful recording of Claire de Lune, it's like, it's pure and beautiful.
Did she say anything about what she likes the best of the music? Because she started with more folk music, with Vivanco, and then she went to Mambo, and then she went to Miracles.
No. The funny thing is, like, we never really... I would ask her about other music, and she didn't refer to it too much. You know, I think she heard things and she knew they existed, but I don't think she went to the record store and said, hey, give me the new Dionne Warwick record or give me the new Streisand record. I don't think it was like that.
I was meaning about her music, her...
No, that's what I'm saying is I don't think she... I think her intellectual process had more to do with her practice and her just refining what she had and keeping her voice the way she had it. I don't think she was like... I don't think she thought about it like, I'm trying to extend this range or I'm trying to get a better throat tone or anything like that.
No.
I think she just knew how to practice, and I think that's what it was.
It was instinctive. I think that it was...
I think at first it was instinctive, but I think also she knew how to practice.
Yeah.
And she knew what she was doing, and she knew how to exercise so she would have better control. Because, as I said, that instrument into her last concerts... No warming up. She would start with the lowest note she had, and by the end of that tune, she would be at the highest.
After what age did she sing?
76, I think.
Can you imagine? I mean, it's incredible. And with the same, I mean, she didn't lose it.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, Willie Nelson doesn't have what he had. You know, when you go see Willie Nelson now, you're going like, yeah, he can't sing what he used to sing. Dionne Warwick can. She's in pretty good shape, but Aretha couldn't. You know, it's rare.
Yeah, totally, totally rare, totally different. But what a privilege! And thank you. We'll see you on Tuesday.
Oh, the honor is mine. I mean, the honor of playing with her is huge. But the honor to, if I'm remembered for something, very likely it'll be that. Oh yeah, you were Yma Sumac's guitarist. You know? Yma Sumac and Bootsy Collins, you know, two very understated figures.
And you made an homage to the musician who made the mambo. Can you tell us?
That's a long story. We'll go into it later. But there's some recordings are starting to be made of Les Baxter's music.
Oh wow!
Because now we can do it in stereo, so you can hear all the parts.
Wow!
Yeah. It's...
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Sorry, how did you end up playing with her?
A magazine sent me as a journalist to write about her because they knew I knew about that type of music. And I got there and lo, it was like a little press party because they were reissuing all the CDs. And I was, there's Yma Sumac. I'm like, wow. There's no mistake. Even if you didn't know who she was, she's one of those people who could walk into the back of a movie theater while the movie is on and everybody would go, you know, she just really exuded something. So, I'm interviewing her, you know, they're like, you have 15 minutes with her. Okay, great. It's a little 500 word piece, no big deal. And I can fill in a lot of stuff. And, of course, it goes over time because she's telling me all these stories about Vivanco and the fights and this and that. And when I mentioned Les Baxter, she had a few things to say about that and recording and Capitol and Hollywood. You know, she was very gracious. And so the guy who was managing her at the time, and this should tell you, like, the level of management that she had, like, walks up and goes, we need a guitar player for some shows, and somebody told me you're a guitar player. I am, but, and I didn't want to say, you have no idea if I suck or not, you know, like, you're just asking a guy off the street, you know. So I said, yeah, I do. And he said, well, obviously you know the music, so they arrange a little audition for me with the piano player, who is the music director, and they hand me one page of Mambo Number 1. And I don't read music very well. And the music was in bad shape, you know, and people had scratched out things all over it and so forth. So I just said, like, well, I'll just fake that I'm reading the music because I know the tune. So he kind of said, bump, 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 bump. And So we get through the tune, and they said, "Wow, that's really good. You not only played what we gave you, but you played the page we didn't give you." So I got the gig, and she liked me because I knew exactly who she was, and knew the music, and because I seemed to know people around town, I became the contractor for the band. So I hired the conga player from War, and the bass player, and you know,
wow.
And the guy who played second keyboards on that gig is in the movie L.A. Confidential.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he plays Jerry Mulligan in the scene where they're having the little cocktail party when they're setting up the gigolo to get killed in the Hollywood Center Motel.
Did you get to know Alex Acuña and Ramon Estañaro?
I've met Alex Acuña, but I don't know.
Yeah. They play with her too, but in a different time, I guess.
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm sure a lot of people went through, because it seemed to me like the management and the music director situation weren't really stable. So,
what did you guys gig mostly?
House of Blues, Montreal Jazz Festival, we did two nights at the Great American Music Hall in San Francisco during Pride Week, which was like, man, that was the unruliest audience I've ever played. I played country music in Bakersfield, and Pride Week playing with Yma Sumac in San Francisco was rowdy.
Wow.
Yeah.
How was her voice in those later years?
First tour, immaculate. So the second tour, you know, we did Montreal. It was mostly still there, but there was a little bit of... she just didn't have at the very top what she had. But that also might have been the fact that we flew to Montreal, and then the next day we're playing the gig, and we weren't very well rested because customs really kept us sitting around for a few hours when we got to Canada, during which time I peeked at her passport to make sure that her real name was indeed. And
yeah, they had a picture of her naturalization certificate.
I know.
Yeah. Nice, I saw nice. The, you know, Empira something something Vivanco. I was like,
that's right.
Yep. No, she was very Catholic, so divorce was not.
But she didn't ever divorce? I thought she divorced. I don't.
She kept the last name.
So she was Catholic?
Oh, I'm sure of it.
Yeah? Did she ever mention anything about
No, but I saw her reach into her purse a couple of times, and, like, there are rosaries in there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You know, Milagros, a lot of Peruvians are Catholic.
No, I know, but I asked Damon, and he said that he didn't think that she was religious.
I don't know if she was necessarily religious, but she was Catholic, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm Jewish, I'm barely going to make it through Yom Kippur, you know, I'll be watching Columbo. But, oh, that doesn't surprise me. But she, like, there was one time I saw her, when we were in Pollo Loco one time, she reached into her little, you know, that little bag she had, and there was like a milk bone for Chilito and some rosaries.
Probably belonged to her mother or something.
Oh, okay.
But she was quite close to the parents. She was mostly Catholic when a plane started to go up off the. And all this.
You know, I saw her. I flew with her, and she was like,
"Yeah." She flew like 50,000 times.
And she was still a little kid from a town full of boats. You know.
Yeah.
No, I mean, like,
Cattle's rough these days, though.
Well, you know, so's Philadelphia. Down by the ports. But the other thing I remember, though, about that flight to Canada is. The jazz festival had been underwritten by Air Canada or whoever their airline was. So the only people on the flight were Yma's band, Yma's manager, and Herb Alpert's band. And Herb Alpert had a hard partying band. Like
they're going on the airplane.
They were they were just like. The girl's like walking by with the little fast cart. Wait a minute. No.
Wow, what a combination. Yma Sumac and her band and Herb Alpert.
Right, because we were all like, you know, we're all like sober as judges, you know, like, we're all going, I have some trail mix, and those guys are like, ay, ay, ay! And then, as I said, when we got to the customs, they were just, you know, like they really gave us a hassle, largely because she wouldn't travel without her dog.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Yeah, Cholito. So, you know.
Cholito.
Cholito.
Thank you.